time at the patient round table, and we thought we'd bring this group of people together to really talk about the patient perspective in relation to the summit and the sorts of things that we should be thinking about. So I'm very pleased to have this group together, and I thank them for their time, and also thank Janelle Bowden, who has helped us coordinate it. So I think you'll find this very, very interesting.
Hi everyone, I'm here with Tanya and David, and we're talking about COVID and the impact on health. So how has COVID and the media's handling of stories about treatments and vaccine development influenced how you feel both about medical research and the industry as a whole? Tanya.
I made a conscious decision early on to not watch a lot of the news, only because I found that what I was hearing was scary, inflammatory. My daughter was, you know, high risk, chances were she was going to die, and it was really a scary kind of thing. So I actually stripped it all back and went to the source, so direct to studies, direct to New South Wales Health websites. And I think it proved the point that to get accurate data and accurate information is go to the people that know. I don't listen to the news when it comes to what's happening with COVID. I want to know what's happening by the doctors. I want to ask her doctor. I want to know about the clinical research. I feel as though finally there's a spotlight being shone on clinical trials and clinical research and how it is so important to how we function as a society and our health moving forward. And I think that we know that because we're in that health space. But if I wasn't in that health space, I wouldn't be as aware of it, I suppose. So I think for me, it's just absolutely solidified the importance of the research, clinical trials, and the healthcare sector as being something that's going to, and I don't want to say this, but I feel like it can possibly be the saviour when we have these moments. So I just feel comfortable knowing that media outlets have sensationalised it far too much for my liking, and I'll just go directly to whatever medical website that I can actually find, whether it be in Australia or overseas.
Yeah, thank you. And David, how about yourself?
I would concur with most of that. My experience, I think it depends a lot on what sort of media you watch and where you get it from. So I'm not really on social media for like Facebook and stuff. So I'm not bombarded with crazy stuff. I'm watching ABC, etc. And I'm getting, I think it's been pretty good, really. Mostly it's in a positive light and reasonably accurate. And, I think it's been okay. And obviously, like Tanya, I would go to direct sources and Google specific websites and try and focus on government and websites that I know that I would trust. So, but generally, I think it's been pretty good, actually. I'd also concur about the clinical trial info. That's been, the more that gets out there, the better. I did a Google yesterday for clinical trial info, and up near the top was a really good Australian government website explaining very clearly information about clinical trials, and I think that's great.
Because of the way that different states in Australia have handled lockdowns and so on, my response is not so much about the treatment, but about just keeping up with what's going on, about what you can access with telehealth, And where you can get, initially people trying to work out who was high risk, where you can get tested, and there was a lot of confusion. So I've actually found that my role myself, I'm actually the editor of Creaky Joints Australia website, is we very quickly found that we had to pull out all the misinformation and actually put it together in a way that people in our community could understand. So it became very important for us to actually get the right information about how you could access telehealth, what was going to be bulk billed, and all the other changes, because I think I was updating some of the articles every week at one point. So for the average consumer to try and keep track of all that was very, very confusing, and I can understand that a lot of people just got so stressed about what they should be doing and when they should be doing it.
Do you think there's been an increased interest in research in your community?
Yeah, our community has always been interested in research, but I'm really glad that the focus is there now to actually highlight it so much more, and vaccines and things as well. So, and just to also make people aware that it's not just elder people that are vulnerable, it's people like us that are actually in a high-risk category too. So that in itself has been a really good thing.
Media messaging that's been driven by government and major institutions, people have reported to me, they find it both simplistic, it's not enough information to inform their own personal situation, and that often it's conflicting. So then people, the media have left people feeling confused and stressed. So that's whole issue of health messaging has been, I don't know that it's been reflecting badly on medical research and the health industry, but it's left people uncertain about their connection to those sectors. So the well-informed community, people like Tanya and David and Rosemary, the well-informed community have been pushing research toward people who are suffering from a lack of information. So that's been, for me, it's not completely unprecedented, but at this level, I think it's new.
That's a fascinating insight, and really shows the value of having conversations with educated consumers like yourself and using you guys to educate your peers. It's a fabulous example.
Thanks.
So thank you for those insights.